They often come to us when things are, you know, new for them. They're new to the, newer to the college. And so this can take a lot of time for them to learn. So yeah, by the way, Kina's just clicked record. If you're not comfortable being recorded, please feel free to jump off or jump off, turn off your camera, whatever suits you. It's not gonna get posted publicly, but it will get posted just to share within the college. So I wanna tell you three stories about students. And these are real students of Dr. McGuire's, something she shares in her book, and we share widely with students. So these students and their majors are listed here. In their first couple of tests, they started out with scores that weren't great on test one, test two. Jamal had some pretty low grades, not passing. Dana and majoring in physics, 50, 54. And then these students participated in a workshop about how to learn, how to become better learners. And these students began to see these scores go up. And their scores went up significantly based on some of the learning. I'm sure there were other things that went on, but some of the things that they learned, some of the strategies taught through Dr. McGuire's workshop, a workshop that's just like what we do. And these were their final grades for the semester. And we share with this with students early when we present to them. And that's because we really want them to buy in, right? We want them to understand that there are some things you can do to turn it around and to change your grades. So how did they do it? Well, these students became expert learners, right? They used the tool we call metacognition to begin to learn and not just focus on studying. And I often ask students, like, how many of you, and I can ask you guys because you know this too, how many of you have ever studied for a test and then taken it and forgotten everything you've learned, right? That's a common experience for college students. Students go, oh yeah, I've done that before. So as I talk to students about this, they start go, oh, I see you're talking about doing something different than maybe I've been doing before. Some of the things that I've relied on into the past. So we really start to see students kind of turn it around. So what is metacognition? And I just go through that a little bit and I'll go through it with you just to make sure we're all on the same page. But the metacognition is thinking about your thinking, right? Thinking of becoming conscious of yourself as a problem solver, as a learner, monitoring and controlling your own mental processes. This is what metacognition is. And here is I like to share a little bit of like, wow, this is really helpful. This is feedback from a faculty member who's been using the ideas behind this in office hours. So this professor says, I'm much more prepared to help my own students who come into my office for advice. Students gain a lot from seeing each step of studying broken down in a way they haven't thought of it before. Helping them gain metacognition and a more accurate understanding of what it really means to study has been really rewarding. So I hope you're getting the clue here. Students don't know this stuff, right? They haven't learned this yet. And I mean, maybe we're surprised by that, maybe we're not, but what we have to deal with the facts, right? And the facts is that we talk to students all week long who really have never been taught how to learn, right? And maybe that's not too surprising. We're gonna do a little thing right now. I'm gonna ask you guys to read something. Read this really quickly. I probably won't give you enough time to go through all of it. But what I'd like you to do is read the paragraph. You're going to try to guess what's going on here, okay? Please don't put it in the chat. Just keep it in your own head and then we'll come back to it. But just take 30 seconds to read the beginning of this paragraph. Your goal is to figure out what's going on here in this paragraph. Okay, just by like a kind of a show of hands, and I can't see everybody's hand, but by a show of hands, how many of you think you know what's going on in this paragraph? Anybody? I can't even see a hand yet. Okay, Lanier. No, Lanier, you're not a good example. You've seen this before. I should have said, if you've seen it before, you know what's going on. Don't give it away. Okay, so here's the thing. Don't feel weird if you don't know what's going on, because you are amongst the majority who do not have any idea what's going on in this paragraph. So now we're going to read it again, but this time I'm going to give you the chapter header for this paragraph. The chapter header is doing laundry. And so let's read it again. The procedure is actually quite simple. First, you arrange items into different groups. Of course, one group may be sufficient depending on how much there is to do. If you have to go somewhere else, that's the next step. Otherwise, you're set. It's important not to overdo it. That is, it's better to do too few things at once than too many. So you see where I'm going with this, right? What's the difference? And you can just drop your ideas in the chat. What was the major difference between the first three read through and the second read through? Context. So, okay, purpose. Yeah. Love a meaningful title. Yeah. So here's the thing. Students show up to class with no context. And then information gets thrown into their face, and not thrown, but you know what I'm saying? Like, they get stuff coming at them. They have no context for it because they haven't spent any time on it before they got to class. And they're completely on their heels, trying to figure out what's going on. When I share this exercise with students, they are just kind of blown away. Like, oh my God, I didn't realize that doing a little bit of work before I go to class on just gaining some context will help me. And we teach this. We teach this to them. And I'm going to talk about that a little bit. I sometimes give the metaphor of like a spider's web, right? So if you're a spider and you go to class and all you've done is kind of an outside silk circle, how many flies are you catching? Like none, right? Like there's this big empty circle, flies just go right through, the spider starves to death, right? So that's what it's like going to class without any context. So we ask students to sort of read and to think about the course material before they get to class, for example. This is learning how to learn. We're teaching them how to learn, and we're making it a lot easier on them by giving them these clues. But I also want to talk a little bit about motivation and autonomy. These are some other areas. And by the way, there's going to be some page references. I'm referencing Dr. McGuire's book, which we have sent out information on how you can access, and we'll make sure that you have more information on that as we go. But we've learned a lot about students' motivation and their ability to sort of be autonomous as learners, or inability as the case may be. So students who appear fearful, unaware, like your student who comes and is like, I don't really know what's going on, or overwhelmed, they may appear unmotivated or lazy. However, there may be something else going on. They may feel on their heels. They may feel out of touch. They may not have understood what college was going to be like and what was going to be the expectations. So showing students how to learn helps them see you both as human and approachable, and also teaches them that learning is actually a thing that you have to do. It's not a passive activity, but it is something that you use your strategies to get there. Empowering students through choices. So giving students some level of autonomy in the classroom and in their schooling can help motivate them. It can help them understand that there are steps to be taken and that they can begin to be in charge of their own learning, which is that metacognition piece, right? Being more aware of their own learning. Setting time for them to learn these steps can be very helpful. I usually call it the slow down to speed up effect, right? We can slow down with our students, teach them some of the steps to the learning that we want them to do in order to help them do it more effectively and be more rewarding for all of us. Overconfidence in students often comes from not knowing what we don't know, otherwise known as the Dunning-Kruger effect, right? This idea that the less you know, the more you're more confident you become because you're not aware of what you're not doing. And we see that in students, don't we? Especially if they've done very well in high school and they're used to succeeding, and then they get to college level and they may not sort of have gotten the skills, and so it can come off as overconfidence. And then more work we've been doing teaching ourselves over these last few years, and this comes from some of our own studies and our own work in the past, is things around what students experience when they, you know, if they have challenges with, you know, the dominant culture of college, and maybe it's something that is quite different for them. If they have been a part of a marginalized group, experienced poverty, racism, sexism, homophobia, you name it, students who come from those marginalized groups may have another added layer on top of what's a challenge for them when they get to college. So we talk about things like stereotype threat. And a few years ago, many in the college read the book Whistling Vivaldi. I love it. I couldn't recommend it enough for you. The idea of high expectations. So one of the things that we know about students is that if we lower our expectations of them, they actually struggle. And they want to have the high expectations and then be taught how to meet those high expectations. And then, you know, we as faculty and staff of the college have built-in social and educational capital just by virtue of our having gone through the schooling systems and having learned how these schooling systems work. And it is our privilege to share that social and educational capital with students and not make an assumption that they already come with that social capital. This is a quote from Dr. McGuire's book. After I bombed the first exam in anatomy in medical school, I went to talk with the professor. He told me that he knew I could excel, but I just needed to change the way I was studying. When I found out that he believed I would succeed, and after he gave me the strategies to do so, it gave me the confidence and motivation I needed to do well in school. So, you know, there it's not just, hey, you're going to do great. It's also getting those strategies from a teacher, learning those expectations. And this is how we've put it into practice at the Learning Commons. And I hope that this will be helpful for you in a couple of ways, know a little bit more about what we're doing, but also seeing how we're weaving this in. Because my overall motivation for sharing this across the college is that we can all be reinforcing one another's work. And I know that this is going on in classrooms and it's going on in the Learning Center. And the more we can support each other, the better. So we train our tutors to use things like open-ended questions, which helps students become more autonomous, right? When students come in, the tutors don't just sit down with them and start working problems. I'm not saying that's never happened. I'm not saying it doesn't happen occasionally, but what we train our tutors to do is not that. So they use forms of questioning, what we call the tutor cycle. How do you start a session? How do you run a session? How do you end a session? These things are meant to always increase students' autonomy so that eventually they learn how to learn the material without the tutors having to do it for them or wanting the tutors to do it for them. So they will always look at where is a student on the continuum of learning. And when we train tutors, by the way, we hear a lot of tutors say, you know, when I started out, when a student came in, I just thought all the students, I treated them all the same, right? Like they came in, I said, what are you working on? I said, okay, here, let's work on that. And then off they went. Now we work with tutors to think about every student who steps in front of you is somewhere different on the continuum of learning around autonomy, right? So how self-guided are they in their learning? And also their level of expertise. And you see this in your classroom, right? Being aware that students are at different places and wanting to think about how can I create assignments, assessments, and activities that will help students along that continuum from where they start to where I need them to be. Our coaches use what we call asking powerful questions to assist students to become agents of their own change. So we're not just sitting down with students and giving them advice, but we're helping students become more autonomous, thinking through what is their process and what are the strategies that are working and strategies that aren't working. And once they begin to analyze their own work, they take more responsibility for changing those strategies or learning, then they're open to learning new strategies. So we talk about coaches providing a time and space for students to explore what is possible, right? So we talk to students about where do you want to be and what are the things that you think will get you there? And the tutor is a guide. They are not there to tell a student, this is exactly how you do it, because we don't know how every student will need to do it. We don't know what their skill sets are and what their preferences are and so forth. This is a feedback from a student that we got a little while ago after a coaching session. I want to let you know that the strategies we discussed about 2 weeks ago have been working great for me. I stopped waking up too early to pre-study. Rather, I adopted 15 to 30 minutes to read through the topic, and it's working well for me. The student's referring to that idea of previewing material before you go to class. They were studying for hours and hours and hours from 3 a.m. until 5 and 6 in the morning, instead of previewing the day's material and going to class with that context that they needed. And just this little kind of turn on the way that the student was approaching the content. They were trying to teach themselves everything, right? Instead of preparing themselves to be taught by their faculty member. And that's the reference. A nice thing to hear a student say that, you know, they make tweaks to their strategies. It doesn't mean that this student gave up on the hours long study sessions. That's also a part of it. But in this case, that's what they were referring. So we talk to students about how they can become better learners. So first of all, we want them to know what learning is. And sorry for the typo in this. I know it's Blooms with an apostrophe, but this was a screenshot. So we talk to students about Bloom's taxonomy, and many of you are familiar with this from the teaching perspective. But what students don't know is what they don't know about your perceptions about learning, right? So we talk to students about this learning cycle in order to help them understand what college is going to be expecting from them. So we talk about the lower levels of learning and the remembering, lots of memorization, recalling, maybe some categorizing, maybe some summarizing. And these are what we call the lower levels of the scale of learning. And then when you go up higher on the scales of learning, then you get into the place where you can begin to teach the material. Obviously, very high up on the learning scale is that teaching and creating, reorganizing, making patterns, beginning to apply the learning to other situations in which you have to analyze the differences, so forth. And then I ask students, what level were you working on this learning scale in high school? I'll ask you guys, what level do you think students are working on, starting at the bottom as 1, just going up? Drop in the chat, where do you think students are working at high school, in high schools typically? There are some high schools that are doing things 1, possibly 3, 1, 2, 1, remembering and understanding. Yep, okay. So you guys are answering the same way that the students answer this question. The students know this. When I show them this, they're like, oh, yeah, we're only working 70%. This is from Dr. McGuire's book. 70% of the students who were surveyed said levels 1 to 3. And I'll tell you the truth. Students say to me, not really 3, though. Not really. Like they say 1 to 3, but then they go, but not really 3. That's how they actually answer the question when I ask it, right? So most of them are very familiar, once we show them this, they're like, oh. And so then I say, but here's the thing, at college, you're going to need to move up this scale. And so how? right? And they've not really been taught how. I wasn't taught how. I don't know about you, but high school didn't say, I'm going to teach you how to climb Bloom's taxonomy scale, right? They're not teaching us that, and students aren't being given those tools. Dr. McGuire has a large section in her book about sort of how the high school teachers approach getting students through the assessments and things that they have to do. And by the way, this is not a critique of high schools or a criticism of high schools. High schools are doing what they need to do in order to get their students to where they need them to be. But for some students, there's going to be a gap between what they're expected to do. So why should we teach Bloom's taxonomy? And I offer this to you as a thought for your work too, right? Not just in the learning center. Students can see the difference between what's expected from them. And so they very quickly get to college and go, oh my God, these expectations are different, right? And they don't know what to do about it sometimes, right? But they can see it. They go, oh, I got it. I see that. They are motivated to learn over studying and forgetting. They want to learn. I say to students all the time, who came here just to get by and just to kind of like get a grade and like move on? They're like, no, I came to college because I really want to be here, right? And I really want to learn. I want to become an expert in something, right? So they really are highly motivated to learn. They just haven't yet figured it out. They understand the difference between active and passive learning as soon as it's pointed out to them. I do this thing that I got from Leslie, thank you, Leslie Rios, about reading and you, students talk about when they study. I ask them all the time, how do you study? I read through my notes. I'm like, how many times do you read through? Three or four times I read through my notes. This passive reading, that's one of the only strategies they have. And it's not good and it's not effective. Leslie will tell you, right? But they do know the difference once you start to show it to them. Dr. McGuire talks about attribution. So describes what we attribute our performance to. So when we ask a student, what strategies did you use, or what strategies do you think you should have used that you didn't? That's very different than asking them, why did you receive a low grade on this test? Do you see the difference? One can attribute blame. Well, my teacher didn't tell me everything that I needed to know. My teacher wrote totally different questions than they had in class. You hear the pointedness. It's often blaming somebody else. They will blame themselves. Please don't think that they don't. They blame themselves a lot. But when we ask them, what strategies did you use? They say, well, I read through my notes three times. Then we can have a conversation about that, right? That's something we can actually address. We can't really deal with blame. And then we teach the study cycle, right? So the study cycle is how we get a student from the Bloom's taxonomy lower levels to the higher levels. And I'm gonna show you the study cycle that we share with students. And you know, we can share that with you as well. It is not a secret. This tool is a great starting point for helping students learn how to study, which is how to become a better learner. We're gonna do this real quick though. All right, so in the next slide, you are gonna count all of the words on the, all of the vowels on this next slide. So just count the vowels. You're gonna have actually not 45 seconds, you're gonna have 30 because you're professionals. All right, so count the vowels. You're not gonna have very long to do it. Okay, how many words do you remember? Put it in the chat. How many words do you remember? All right, Anne. Couple. So I assume if you're putting a single word in, that's the only one you remembered. Okay, all right. Okay, so a few, maybe a couple. So we're gonna do it again. This time, I would like you to memorize as many words as you can in 30 seconds, not 45, but I'm going to give you guys 30 because you're professionals. Okay, go ahead. Let's try to memorize as many words as you can. Okay, how many words or phrases do you remember? How many? You don't have to pop the words in, just maybe like count how many words. Okay. So now we're gonna do it again. Some of you guys are doing pretty good, but you know, not great, right? Like, I mean, there were a lot of words there and maybe you got half of them, maybe, you know, you got some. Let's try it one more time. This time we're going to look at it, but I'd like you to take a look at how the words are organized on the page. And then let's see if you can remember a few more than you did before. So you might have noticed that it starts with dollar bill, dice, tricycle. You see the pattern, 1, 2, 3. Now, if you were to, and we won't spend too much time on this, but if you were to try to memorize these, I think you would probably boost your performance by, you know, 25 to 35, 40% just by having the organizational patterns. So somebody doesn't know I'm busy right now. So what was the difference between the first attempt and the second attempt? I already kind of mentioned it. Any thoughts about that or any words that you would share in terms of what the differences were? Okay, I told you what to look for. A change in the purpose. The second time I knew what to look for. You actually looked at the words, okay. So the second and third times, you knew a little bit more about what the task was, but you also knew something really important, which was the information was organized in a particular way. And that makes all the difference, right? So students come to class, they work on homework assignments, and they have not figured out the code, right? You guys hold the code. The students don't have the code yet. You can often boost their performance by helping them find patterns or seek out ways of approaching the material, right? So it's not just, this was one example of organization in your field. It might be something different, but you all hold a lot of knowledge about how to approach the material that will actually get them performing better, right? And that's the kind of thing that when we talk to students about this, we say, you know, we want to help you find the strategies that get you learning the material and help you organize it and approach it in a way that is beneficial for that topic or that that field of study. And it can be very different from the math to the sciences. So this is what we talk about with students, that what we call the study cycle. And so we ask them sort of like, how can you move yourself up those levels of learning, move yourself up on that scale. And this is the tool that Dr. McGuire created many years ago. It's been improved upon over time, and it's called the study cycle. And we use this with students all the time. And it is kind of one of those things where you see like the scales fall off the eyes for students when they get a technique and a strategy how to approach their learning. And so the way this is organized is you'll see on the right-hand side, the focused study session. I always tell students, that's what you do like when you throw your backpack on your shoulder and you say you go into the library to study, that's your focused study sessions. The cycle on the left-hand side is what you do throughout the week and repeatedly in order to learn, not just study, right? And so you start with the preview, you and previewing is that kind of the piece about starting some formation of knowledge so that when you go to class, you're not ice cold and totally out of context, right? You spend some time on that. You go to class, and I ask students all the time, how many of you have ever kind of started to bargain with yourself 2 or 3 weeks into class that maybe attending doesn't need to happen? And they're like, oh yeah, I've done that before. And I'm like, you know, that means that you are taking one of the major steps out of your learning, right, is to be able to go to class and apply that information that you've been previewing. So we talk a lot about that. Then the review, which is, you know, right after class, do you spend time looking back through the course, the day, filling in gaps? Students don't do this, right? And when I this is the, actually, I don't know if Kina could say differently, but reviewing is one of the things that students say, you know what, I have never done that. And it makes so much sense to me that you would sit down and fill in the gaps, you know, so you know, give the students some sense of like how this 15 to 20 minutes can really help them. And then the studying, which is what's on the right-hand side, that's that kind of stage of studying, and then checking in. Actually asking yourself, are my strategies working? Should I be doing more, right? Or should I be doing something different, I should say. It's not always about more, it's often about different, right? So that's kind of the study cycle. So in the beginning, I told you that we teach students strategies, right? Well, when we try to teach them this with no context, they just kind of go, oh, that sounds great. I don't really know. But when we start to talk about it, after we've talked about the process of learning, becoming a better learner and not just studying for the sake of studying. So we talk about, you know, when you solve problems, do solve the problem all the way without looking at the solution. And then when you look at the solution or the answers, then go back and figure out what you did in that problem, where you went off the mark when you got the problem wrong. Don't just go, oh, this is what students do. And they'll admit to it all the time. They look at the answer after they've worked the problem, they got stuck. They look at the answer and then they go, oh, okay, good. And they move on to the next problem. So we talk to them about not doing that, but going back to figure out how and where they went wrong. We talk about memorization. It's not all about memorization, but there are some things you're going to want to memorize. And I'm a passionate lover of flashcards. Like, I just love them so much. So we talk about that and how they can use them to their benefit. But that, you know, they got by on memorizing for so long that they think that's the only thing to do. And so we have to kind of put memorization in the right context. We talk about asking why, how, and what if questions. Sorry, English people in the room, I didn't put those in quotes. I know I should have. Ask those questions, like critical questions, instead of just the what, right? And I talk with students a lot about what is remembering and memorizing, right? That's what. The rest of it, the why, the how, the what if, that's when you start to actually apply information and make connections from one thing to another and begin to actually get a critical understanding of the information. Test your understanding by giving many lectures. And so we start to now talk about interacting with peers, study groups. If you don't have one though, you can lecture your teddy bear for all I care. Talk to your aunt and tell her what you're learning, because the more you can get your brain engaging in something other than passive listening and reading, the more you will begin to learn this material. Spend time each day on every course. Students tell us all the time, they take the weekend off. Have you ever heard a student say that? I take the weekend off. They say it so blasé too. I'm like, what? Like, no, you know, so we have to talk about that sort of like revisiting material in smaller bits and spending time with things every day. But students, you know, they're exhilarated to be in college and they're grownups and they can take the weekend off if they want to. They're so excited about that idea, but it's really not very, you know, it's counterproductive for many of them. And some, of course, they work in all of those things. And we do talk about that. I don't want to negate that there are students who have a lot of other responsibilities. So we talk about how can you work this in? And we spend a lot of time on time management, by the way. That's a whole nother lecture. So, and then we talk about using the study cycle, visiting, this is shameless plugs for the tutoring centers and so forth. And then we talk about 100% mastery. So students get like, okay, I've done good enough. And they just walk off and they're like, okay, that was probably good enough. So we encourage them to sort of aim for mastery. So, and then the last thing, one of the last things that we really try to cover, and I like to talk to you all about this as much as our students. And some of this comes from, many of you have seen Omid Fatui, who came to visit the college a few times over the past few years. And some of his research on our very own students about mindset have impacted the way that I think about mindset. One of the things about mindset is that I think we really misapply it a lot, right? So for example, a lot of us find ourselves saying to students like, you're gonna do great. That you're gonna be, you know, keep working and you're gonna be great, right? And that is not really what a growth mindset is. A growth mindset really has more to do with how we understand intelligence, right? So we believe that you can, you know, in a fixed mindset, you may believe that, you know, intelligence is static versus the idea that intelligence can be developed over time. And when I do this presentation with some of this presentation with students and I talk about a growth mindset, I often give an example of my own experience as a learner. I'm a twin, some of you know that, and I have a twin brother who was obnoxiously able to get A's in high school without doing anything. And it drove me bonkers because I worked hard and I was still barely a C student. And I struggled to get through high school. And I really, you know, just didn't ever understand quite why. When we got to college, this is a great scientific experiment on twins, right? When we got to college, he began to struggle and I began to succeed. And the reason was because I had developed this mindset that I could continue to learn and that I would put in these kind of certain efforts in certain ways. And luckily, somewhere along the way, somebody told me how to do the work without just like working hard, digging a big hole, right? Because you can work really hard and not get anywhere, like the horse in Animal Farm, right? So, you know, with a fixed mindset, you believe that you have a certain amount of intelligence versus this idea that you can grow your intelligence over time. These last two points are very, these two and the next one are very relevant to our students. I would say, you know, and I'm sure many students, but Santa Fe students in particular. So with a fixed mindset, failure results in blame versus failure being an opportunity to grow. And our students, and I'm not sure I understand all of the ins and outs of it, but there can be, because we do have a lot of highly successful students who came from high schools where they did quite well. We have high achievers. They often don't understand once they come up against failure, why? And so they just look around for reasons, right? They're like, who is to blame for this, right? And I mean, like I said, a lot of them blame themselves, but they look for blame. And that is really a point of a fixed mindset versus a growth mindset that says, hey, look, you know, I came up against failure and that's actually my starting point now, right? And I ask students like, did you think that you were gonna come up to college and everything was just gonna be so easy? And they're like, no, I didn't actually think that. But when I got up against failure, I didn't realize that it was proof that I was learning, right? So failure, if you've never failed, you've never tried, right? And so we talk about that with students. And that really connects with students. They do connect with that. And again, you can see them kind of understand that. And with students, a fixed mindset is really focused on the now versus the yet. And this was one thing I really got from Omid, his feedback for us, was this idea that when our students come up against failure, it's like this for them. This is all they can see, right? And so they don't really have the ability to look past the now. And it is catastrophic. And they can't see their way around it versus the not yet, right? This idea that, hey, this thing that's in front of me, this big giant F on the paper that I just turned in, whatever it might be, that means I'm not there yet. And this is the this kind of this idea, what Omid Fatui calls time construal, right? Is that their construal of time is very limited versus being able to look beyond that to the future, the coming, the not yet there. And that's very powerful for students. And when I talk about that, you know, I say to them, have you ever been, you know, in a situation where a failure was right here and you really couldn't see beyond it at all? And they're like, oh yeah. Like they're just stopped. They cannot see past that. And so we work with them and we want to help them to see that those things are opportunities. So then, you know, I offer you all this idea, and we, and in Dr. McGuire's book, she talks about partnering with your learning centers and with your learning support services in order to take the threads of what you do in your classroom and what we do in the learning center and actually begin to positively reinforce one another's message. And please don't think that I don't think that a lot of this stuff that I'm talking about goes on in your classrooms. I know it does. And in fact, the thing I think for students is they haven't yet gotten enough context to really start to put together all of the moving pieces of what college is. So they have these moments and these experiences over here and over there. And sometimes they don't really know. And it's about connecting these dots. And my hope for us as a college is that we continue to be able to positively reinforce one another's work in this way. And so, you know, so some of these things, and I'm not going to go through these at all. You're welcome to even just take a picture of this slide if you want. But what you should know is the point of this slide is to say that we want to work with you. And that you are welcome at any time to send me an email and just say, hey, Lee, man, I got a great idea. I'd like to talk about how we can partner with the Learning Center. Many of you who are here today have done that before. And thank you, you know, and we love it. We're excited about it. We do a lot of trial and error. We do a lot of kind of like, we do something, maybe it works, maybe it hasn't, but we'll keep trying with you and keep building on it. We love the feedback and we want to keep trying to work on these things. So what I say to students at the very end of a presentation where I've just kind of blown their hair back, you know, they're all just like, oh my God, Lee, I say to them, you know, here's the thing, knowledge is power, right? Like, you know, today what you didn't know before, 45 minutes ago, you didn't know some of this stuff and now you know it. And that is the point. That's the starting point. You can work with that. And this is encouraging to them. This is something that they really, they can take this in without freaking out about it, without shutting down. It feels good for them to know this. So this is the book that we are talking about, that the speaker who is coming in March 19th, in the morning, please hold it on your calendars. Dr. Sandra McGuire, this is her book. We have unlimited copies of this book in the library, electronic ebook in the library for the library. I think we do have a couple of print copies as well. And I give mine away every time I buy one, I give it away. So if you want mine, you're welcome to it. I literally can't keep them because I give them away. But we also have in Canvas right now, we've posted sort of a Canvas shell with a book discussion. We've taken a few highlights from the chapters just to kind of get ready for Dr. McGuire's visit. And so if you want to either take a picture of this QR code right now, it'll take you, if you're not logged into Canvas, it'll take you to the Canvas page where you log in and it'll take you right to the McGuire book discussion. Or here's a web link that you can pop into your browser as well. If your phone has a camera and you just point your camera at that QR code, it's gonna pop up and you're gonna, unless your phone's really old or a flip phone, I can't help you, but you can just take a picture of that QR code and go, but you will have to log in. So when you hit the Canvas page, just log in. If you'd like to jump in there and have some discussion, there's a few key questions, like we've tried to highlight a few chapters and just say, like, in this chapter, she says this, what do you think? So if you don't have time to read the whole book right now, before her visit, you could at least look at some of the highlights. So that is what I had for you today. I know that I said that it would be 50-minute presentation. So you guys owe me 3 minutes of your time. Is that right? Yeah, 3 minutes. I want to hear what you think. I want to hear what this has got you kind of dreaming about. Maybe something that is challenging about this. Feel free to drop chats or come off mute and say some things. Thank you, guys.
So I have placed a link to a feedback survey if you just need some time to process all this information, and you'll have an opportunity to click on the link and provide your feedback and also suggest some other workshop topics that you might be interested in.
And I see your chat. We do time management, and I'll talk about that. Go ahead, Patty.
I really want to thank you, because I felt like listening to what you were saying, I felt like we are so close on the same page when we get students coming into the college for the first time. And if our goal as developmental reading teachers is to help them learn how to learn, you know, the process is more important than the product.
Yeah.
That's what I kept hearing you say, and I appreciate that.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I always think about that, that kind of slow down to speed up effect, right? Like sometimes focusing on the process helps the students get to the product, which, I mean, of course the product is super important to all of us, right? But the idea of like how they get there and the time that they've spent is super important. Many of you saw the announcement that we turned the digital learning plan on. Yes, on Wednesday night, Thursday morning. We've already had 40 students take a survey that is available in there, and one of the things that it asks them about is what do they think that they could use help with at this point. This morning, I sat down with the very first 40 responses. It's not a high response out of the total number. We've loaded like 1,700 students into it. But of the 40 who took, and this is optional, so you know we weren't surprised that it would take a while. But the number two thing that students said that they could use assistance with, I was actually quite surprised, was time management and motivation. Is anybody else surprised by that? I mean, no. Yeah. Like I was a little surprised that they owned that so fast, I guess, because these are new students, right? And they already know.
Well, in the participating in the co-requisite meetings all last semester, you know, those wrappers, I've been doing it in Dev Ed, and it's amazing when you said what you said about the learning process. And they say, I read this many times or that many times, that's the beginning of a starter conversation as to, okay, now that you're reading, what does that really mean? And, you know, getting into those questions, it's a perfect segue for that. So this workshop kind of reiterated that to me for the next step of the wrapper. Yeah. Now, you know, what do we do with it? Thank you.
I have to say, I love talking to students about time management, because there's so much payoff so quickly. And I know that other of the academic success coaches in the room with me today here can attest to this. It does not take a lot to get, it only takes a little effort to get a lot of payback on this investment with our students, because time management really is something you can do. And I'm not brilliant in my own life, but I've actually gotten a lot better because I practice what I preach. I will say that it is one of the more satisfying things, just to give students hope. And I get kind of choked up about it, how much hope students walk away. Like, I'm like, it's amazing to me profoundly how changed they are to realize how manageable their time is and how productive they can be. And they get quite effusive with us and their coaches. They say some of the most lovely things about their coaches because they've gotten this kind of gift around time management of all things. You know, it's pretty neat. And sometimes it's pretty profound.
It's great to have them there that we can send our students, because that is the number one downfall is time management. They don't have time to study. They don't know how to figure it all out, but we have people now that can help them do that. And I thank you for that.
Thank you so much. Well, I'm here, I'm chilling. So if other people wanna chat and take comments and make comments and questions, I'm happy to keep chatting. But also I know some of you are gonna hop off, and please do if you need to go. And thank you all so much for attending. We did record this, so we'll post it and get the word out to chairs where it can be found. You share it with your colleagues and so forth.